Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 12th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. The first item on our agenda is for members of the committee to agree or not to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. We've received apologies from Colin Beattie, and I'd like to welcome Bill Kidd, who joins us on the committee this morning. The principal item that we have consideration of today is the 2021-22 audit of Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow Holdings Limited. And I'm pleased to welcome our witnesses this morning. Auditor General Stephen Boyle, welcome. And the Auditor General this morning is joined by Mark Taylor, who's an Audit Director at Audit Scotland, and Joanne Brown, who's a partner at Grant Thornton. We've got quite a number of questions to put to you this morning, but before we get to those, Auditor General, could I ask you to make a short opening statement?
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I'm presenting this report this morning on the 2021-22 audit of Ferguson Marine Glasgow Holdings Limited, under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000. The Scottish Government brought the Ferguson Marine Shipyard into public ownership in 2019. It is now a limited company, wholly owned by the Scottish Government and also a non-departmental public body. As the committee well knows, Ferguson Marine is contracted to build two ferry vessels, the Glen Sannox, also known as Vessel 801, and Vessel 802, with the Scottish Government funding these costs under contract. The auditors issued an unqualified audit opinion on Ferguson Marine's 2021-22 financial statements. In doing so, they also highlighted risks and uncertainties to the financial viability of FMPG within their audit certificate. This judgment from the auditors draws on the management's own assessment of its ability to operate as a going concern for the following 12 months. Convener, at the time of reporting, Ferguson Marine estimates suggest that around £9.5 million of additional funding was required beyond the amount already approved by Parliament. This would bring the total direct vessel-related costs to £293 million. This figure, though, excludes other funding that the Scottish Government has provided to the yard. In December 2022, the Government issued what's known as a letter of comfort to the FMPG Board to provide assurances that it intended to financially support FMPG for at least a further 12 months from February 2023. The former Deputy First Minister has since informed Parliament that the Scottish Government's full assessment and due diligence of costs is due to conclude shortly. The Chief Executive has confirmed that FMPG aim to work within existing cost estimates. It remains critical that the Scottish Government and FMPG work together to establish and clarify funding and plans both for the vessels and for the yard itself as quickly as possible. This will, of course, help provide more certainty to both the workforce and island communities. Convener, my report also highlights that six senior managers at the yard were paid performance bonuses of £87,000. It is, in my view, unacceptable that these payments were made without proper governance and oversight arrangements. On the 16th of March, the former Deputy First Minister also assured Parliament that new processes had been put in place aimed at ensuring that this doesn't happen again. Convener, I will of course continue to monitor Ferguson Marine's progress during 2022-23 and report further in public as appropriate. As you've mentioned, I'm joined by Joe Brown, who is the appointed external auditor from Grant Thornton, and Mark Taylor, Audit Director with a great deal of familiarity of the workings of ferries in Scotland from an audit perspective. And between the three of us, we look forward to answering the committee's questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. I'd like to begin by going back to what's been a recurring theme with the delivery of these two vessels, which is about cost overruns. But in particular, I want to ask you about paragraph 13 of the report, in which you draw attention to the fact that during October to mid-December 2022, Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow made expenditure commitments of between £10 and £15 million, more than the Scottish Government had allocated. So I guess the obvious question is, how could that be? Was it appropriate? And where was the sponsorship team of the Scottish Government during this?
You're right to draw attention to this, Convener. This was it's a serious issue, and I think it reflects a wider concern. I'll come back to address the specifics of the point in a moment about what's ambiguity about the arrangements in the yard in terms of projected future spending, the Scottish Government's oversight of that. And you know, whilst it was resolved with a subsequent letter of comfort from the Scottish Government, there does point to here concerns about in-year spending. And then what would have happened had the Scottish Government not provided the letter of comfort, and what that might have meant for the delivery of the project. So you ask about the kind of role of the sponsorship team, and Jo can come in and say a bit more about that in a moment if she wishes. But it really speaks, I think, wider concerns that we highlight both in the Section 22 report and very clearly in Grant Thornton's annual audit report, that there remains ambiguity about how oversight works in terms of the day-to-day sponsorship arrangements. The lack of clarity that is within the framework document that sets out how the relationship between FMPG and the Scottish Government operates, that goes absolutely to the heart of the financial transactions that exist, but also extend into other matters that include governance and pay arrangements too. So I'm keen to say more about those matters, Convener, but I'll stop and just bring Jo in if she wishes to elaborate.
In particular, in terms of that time period, there were ongoing discussions between FMPG and the Scottish Government sponsor team, and that from what we understand, there were a number of verbal agreements. From the perspective of the FMPG board, they were looking for those assurances more formally in writing, which, as the Auditor General said, did come in December through the letter of comfort. At this particular point in time, the accountable officer of FMPG also sought advice from Scottish Government around their role and remit as accountable officer, the nature of the commitments that FMPG had incurred. And we understand it was a particular timing issue around the budget announcement in the December period, which set out the future funding for FMPG. But the sponsor team were aware. The issue seemed to be more around that hard commitment from the sponsor team that funding would be provided to FMPG, which created a risk and uncertainty for them in this time period.
But Auditor General, you spoke about ambiguity and the framework agreement not being as clear as it might be. I mean, how do you think that sponsorship team's relationship should be with an NDPD like this, you know, when there is presumably not insubstantial amounts of public money, £10 to £15 million, that need to be committed? I mean, does it come as a letter of comfort at the end? I mean, we've heard this before in other circumstances around this contract. Does it come as a letter of comfort at the end of the process, or shouldn't there be some kind of prior sign-off by the sponsorship team or by the minister or whoever to allow that expenditure to be committed?
I would characterise it in general, Convener, that the relationship should be one of respective understanding of risk and opportunity, so that, and I know the committee has had a keen interest in sponsorship arrangements and how they operate across the Scottish Government and its bodies for many years. Where there are higher risk entities, and I think it is reasonable to say that Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow would be categorised as such, that would involve a higher level of day-to-day engagement from a sponsor team. It's probably not for me to specify the specifics of what that would mean in terms of sign-off of individual transactions or spending. But the reason that we include that in today's report is because it speaks to an example of surprise from our perspective, that spending beyond budget was committed and that resulted in a letter of comfort thereafter. You would have thought that if that was the anticipated spend that was required, that would have been managed in advance rather than retrospectively. The totality of sponsorship arrangements we haven't covered in detail in today's report as it relates to FMPG and the Scottish Government, but we do draw attention, and as equally do Grant Thornton in their annual audit report, about a need for additional clarity on how that relationship will operate, the need for the framework document to be clearer, clarity around governance arrangements too, and the last point that's particularly relevant in these circumstances is around value for money. The Scottish Government is asking Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow in terms of its future spending to be very clear on the value for money that will be derived from the use of public funds. But value for money, as we know, and indeed a conversation that I've had with the committee over the past few weeks in terms of value for money judgments, is a rounded assessment. But the criteria for that assessment need to be defined, and they haven't been so yet. All of this work needs to happen quickly.
Thanks. And I mean, as you raise this, I mean, for the avoidance of doubt, this enterprise must comply with the Scottish Public Finance Manual guidance, shouldn't it? I mean, so for example, there should be openness and transparency, there should be value for money, and there should be things like an internal audit function. I mean, the my reading of the external auditor's report is that there was not at the time of reporting an internal audit function. Is that still the case?
I'll bring Joe in a second just to update on the status of that, but I thought I'd maybe say a word about the Scottish Public Finance Manual first, convener. And again, this is, the risk of repeating myself, is another example of, I think, the ambiguity that exists as it relates to Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow Holdings Limited, which is a non-departmental public body, but it's also a company limited by guarantee registered with Companies House. So both those factors are having to coexist. And in some circumstances, there has to be a judgment as to, because there can be competing criteria around those registration. Some will involve openness and transparency, you say, but it's also a commercial entity and that will engage in commercial transactions that won't always be in its interest to be entirely open and transparent. What we don't have, and what I think neither Ferguson Port Glasgow nor the Scottish Government have been clear yet, and I think Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow absolutely deserves to have this clarity in its framework document about how it can run its business. But the absence of that clarity will mean that these factors will rub up against one another, compete, perhaps result in delays. These need to be resolved quickly. On the factor of internal audit, before handing to Joe, as you would expect me to say, convener, an effective internal audit function, especially for an organisation like Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow, is an essential component of its control environment, a key tool of management to support its management of risk. We understand that progress is being made, and there are references in the annual report and accounts to disclose the circumstances. But again, its absence would be a deficiency in the management ability to run the yard to best effect. Again, I'll stop. I think Joel want to come in and say her judgment and where things are at.
Yeah. I think in terms of that, the framework document and the letter issued to the accountable officer highlights that FMPG is required to comply with the SPFM. That's something FMPG are aware of, and they've spent time, as the Auditor General said, looking at what part of those arrangements they are currently deficient in and what would they need to happen to put those arrangements in place to allow full compliance. And they have disclosed that within the governance statement in the accounts. In terms of the position for internal audit, it was something we raised in our prior year audit as well as within this audit report. And it is something that the audit committee have considered and have looked into the possibility of internal audit. And I know they've explored a number of options around that. One of the challenges they have and one of the areas they've focused in on is predominantly the delivery of 801, 802. With internal audit, there is obviously an associated cost with internal audit, and they are speaking to the sponsor team around that. And this in part links to the need that we've highlighted in our external audit report and in the section 22 around that wider business plan and the future direction of the yard. And that would also shape the investment in internal audit for Ferguson Marine. So it is in process, and they have disclosed that they don't currently have that, and they are speaking to Scottish Government about how that potentially would be funded.
Thanks. Before I move on to the Deputy Convener, I just wanted, because you've couched it in those terms, Auditor General, about there being a tension between the fact it's a company limited by guarantee and yet it's some of its governance is also dictated by the Scottish Public Finance Manual. I mean, there's been a report in a national newspaper today about the commissioning of some consultancy work which is trying to scope what needs to be put in place for the company to thrive in the future. And the report suggests that the people carrying out the report, FMI, requested a non-disclosure agreement around their report. I think initially the Scottish Government said there wasn't an NDA. They've now accepted that there is an NDA in place. And there's talk about commercial sensitivities, and of course we all understand there will be some commercial sensitivities, but there is also a public interest, and there must be a way through that which would allow as much of that report to be in the public domain and subject to some scrutiny as possible. I just wonder whether you were aware of that, whether you've got any reflections on that.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. On the specifics, no, we weren't aware of this. We haven't seen the report and only became aware of it when the article was brought to our attention. The transactions, as I understand it, will have been in the new financial year, the one that has just completed the 22-23 audit. So the external auditors will consider that as part of their audit. Stepping back to the wider point, though, is that, and as we've discussed already, there is something of a tension between the requirements of the Scottish Public Finance Manual, Ferguson and Port Glasgow being a non-departmental public body, and also being a company operating in a commercially competitive environment. To repeat, that the government and FMPG need to come to a shared understanding of what that means. I should say, Convener, that as you would expect me to say, I don't think that overrides the need for openness and transparency, given the very strong parliamentary and public interest in the work of the yard, the delivery of the vessels, and its future. Indeed, our Section 22 report, part of that is the driver for that shared understanding, that clarity being provided as quickly as possible. On the work that, as it's framed in the article, the intent behind the consultancy work about future options, I don't know the status of that, but it sounds like there are parallels between the Scottish Government's own assessment of the future of the yard, the report that's awaited from the Scottish Government. There are two pieces of future consideration that are mentioned and sometimes mixed up. One is about a due diligence of costs that took place at the end of last year, but the other is the wider report that the Scottish Government is currently working on, and say we await publication that, as I understand, will set out what the government views as the future provision options. We think that needs to happen quickly so that there is clarity for both people who work at Ferguson and Port Glasgow and also for Scotland's Islands communities.
Thank you very much. And I think we may return to some of those questions in the course of the next hour. But I'm going to bring Sharon Dowie in, who's got a series of questions to put. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning. The Scottish Government issued a letter of comfort to FMPG, providing assurances that FMPG would be supported financially for at least 12 months from February 2023. Does that mean that FMPG can continue to make expenditure commitments, such as the ones made between October and December 2022, beyond its allocated budget for the year?
I'll start. I'll bring Mark in a moment. Actually, can say a bit more about the Scottish Government's role in supporting the delivery of the vessels. At a high level, the contract exists between the Scottish Government now and Ferguson and Port Glasgow for the delivery of the vessels. The committee has previously explored, I recall, with the Scottish Government about an evidence that you took on the Section 23 report about the nature of that commitment, the extent to which it was managed and evaluated by government. But it's our understanding that the commitment remains and is linked to timescales. So if milestone dates, I should say, are met, the contract continues and amounts will be paid. If dates slip, as they have done, there is an opportunity to consider a break in the contract. If that's not exercised within, I think it's a 14-day period, it's assumed that the contract continues and will be funded. We draw attention to this in today's report because it's critical as part of an auditor's assessment of going concern arrangements that the business can continue to exist for 12 months after the date of the signing of the annual report and accounts. Management's assessment were that they could, but they also draw attention based on doubts about, not doubts I should say, just following their review of cash flow, the provision of the letter of comfort and their assumptions in the draft budget were the factors that allowed them to make that assessment. But quite rightly, Grant Thornton in their audit certificate draw attention to those judgments. I'll pause, Deputy Convener, and Mark can come in and say a bit more about the Scottish Government's role.
Yeah, thank you, Auditor General. I think starting point for me is around recognition that the Scottish Government in committing any expenditure is subject to parliamentary approval of its budgets, and that there's a parliamentary approval process around those budgets. And in offering letter of comfort, and these things are often quite nuanced in what the government is able to offer up and give a degree of comfort to public bodies and their boards and to auditors, and its requirement to have that approval from Parliament, spending authority from Parliament. And the specifics around this letter of comfort include caveats, which broadly say subject to approval of budgets by Parliament, and importantly, any further due diligence that might be required from Scottish Government itself before it signs those costs off. So the idea is it signed costs off after a certain level. If Ferguson Marine says it's going to cost more, although there's that commitment to provide that cover, that's subject to them looking in detail about the amounts that have been quoted to make sure that those are robust, for the want of a better phrase. So there's a clear caveats in that, and those caveats were also taken into account by the board of Ferguson Marine and Joan and Grant Thornton in their work as part of that wider package that the Auditor General talks about. More generally, there's that point of, well, does that mean that they can spend beyond their budget if they have to? I think what we'd say about that is, in the same way as we covered the existence of the 15 million, a better position is to have clarity about what that expectation is and what the budget cover for that is. And then if they were to continue to spend in that way, the letter of comfort gives a degree of assurance that those costs will be met, but subject to those caveats.
So if they spend more money, will that need to come back to Parliament then? You're saying they've got to hit milestone payments?
So
milestone targets?
How I'd articulate it is, as part of future budget revisions, future budgets and future budget revisions, it would be part of that package of the wider budget that would be approved by Parliament, because Parliament generally won't approve individual elements of the budget, but as part of that overall budget approval. And one of the reasons we touched on earlier for the gap between expenditure commitments being entered into and cover by budgets was the timing for that parliamentary approval and the process around that parliamentary approval. So we wouldn't expect to see that specific spending line approved in isolation, but that being part of wider budget approval or wider budget adjustments.
State that FMPG funding requests are subject to due diligence by the Scottish Government. Can you provide more detail about the process that's in place for the work to take place?
So just broadly about what due diligence is. So essentially, due diligence is a broad church, and it's generally concerned with confirming the facts of a matter before a decision is made in relation to the financial decisions. So broadly, it's about an assessment of the robustness of the amount of money that's been asked for and the basis for that and how that's been assessed, and bringing in quite often, and was the case here, some independent experts to look at the basis for that, get into the nuts and bolts of where's your evidence for that, essentially, and to provide views on that. And we set out in our report some of the outcomes that came from that due diligence review and some of the uncertainties that were in place in paragraph 12. Thank you, Mr. General. Paragraph 12, what some of those issues are. I think what that highlights is that, and our broader point in our report, is these costs are uncertain. There's some things that might, and we all hope this is the case, reduce those costs because efficiencies are identified and rework's minimised and some of those things. But equally, inflation, some of the uncertainties and contingencies might mean costs move around. So the results of that we've highlighted in paragraph 12 of the report.
Next question. The report also highlights that there could be future funding requirements of around £9.5 million. Based on FMPG's estimate of final cost. The report also highlights that the consultant commissioned to review FMPG's financial forecast raised some concerns, including the estimate of contingency being too low. On that basis, how realistic do you consider the future funding requirement of £9.5 million to be?
I think it's hard to be definitive about that at the moment. So that's the best current estimate, effectively, Deputy Convener, we would... is the judgment of the Scottish Government and the Ardent. I think, as Mark says, about really the outcome of the due diligence exercise suggests that they need to build more contingency into the estimates. That seems pretty sensible, given what we've seen already of this project, that it's continued to cost more and take longer than had been expected. So building in larger contingencies, together with the assessment of the risks that remain. And the last point was around the drawing attention to some of the risks for delivery. So the consultant's note around supply chain pressures, the wider circumstances in the construction sector, inflation, building inflation, and what that might mean for future cost estimates and delivery timescales. So it's probably that. It's the best estimate that was available. But I think it would be folly to suggest that that's a reliable final number that will be spent to deliver the vessels at this stage. It needs close, careful management, and that going back to that, and really regular engagement with FMPG and the Scottish Government, together with approval requests at the right point to Parliament and through the Chief Executive. And his update to the Net Zero Committee on progress.
Let's go on to the last one, last question. To what extent is the Scottish Government preparing for a future funding requirement, recognising that financial assurances have only been provided until February 2024?
So I think it's subject to ongoing review and anticipation. We set out at Exhibit 1 to the... to the report to draw to the committee's attention, the balance is spent to date, and then the, as you mentioned, Deputy Convener, a budget of £57.6 million in the 2023-24 budget. I really probably risk of saying again, I don't think it's possible to say with certainty that that's it. You know, this project has been subject to regular review of costs, additional costs, additional timescales. And I know, as I'm sure the committee will have heard clearly, the former Deputy First Minister advised Parliament on the changes to the timescales for the delivery of MV Glen Sannox and also the anticipated longer timescale for the delivery of Vessel 802. That's the most up-to-date position that we also understand, and really repeat that this project, it does require clarity through Parliament, through the public, and that will come through real close, regular management of costs and anticipated timescales.
So the letter of comfort was given in 2023, and it's covering them until February 24. So the latest update that we've got is that 801 or Glen Sannox would be finished by the summer or the end of 2023, the very, very latest. 802 in the latest update says that it would be summer 24 or the end of 2024 at the latest, which is actually out with the letter of comfort. And we're looking at their milestone payments, which looks as if they've already kind of slipped on timescales. And we've already said that I think we can't be definitive in whether that cost will be accurate. So we've asked officials before about whether this was a blank cheque until the boats were completed. Is this, in effect, a blank cheque?
Maybe to start with just the dates, if I may. In terms of 802, I think it's expectation of autumn 2024 was the former Deputy First Minister's statement, with a backstop date, I think was the phraseology that was used, of December 2024. So you're right that in terms of timescales and public expenditure, that will be into the 2024-25 budget, which of course hasn't been considered by Parliament. That will be a matter for parliamentary consideration in due course. But I think it's indicative that, you know, spending close management that continues to be required. You've asked the question, and the committee's asked the question, as to whether or not there is an open-ended commitment. I think, as I mentioned a couple of minutes ago, contractually that's not quite the case. There are, and Mark might want to say a wee bit more about this, there are potential breaks in the contract as it relates to not delivering the vessels in accordance with the timescales, and it's the timescales that matter. However, it's accepted that the contract continues and continues to be funded unless the funding party, the government, says otherwise, should those delivery timescales not be met. So there are opportunities both to review timescales and future commitments still to come, but those are the most up-to-date dates that we're aware of, Deputy Convener. Mark might want to say a bit more.
Thank you, Auditor General. I think the only thing I have to add from me is, in terms of the length of the letter of comfort and why it's 12 months from that date, that's largely a technical reason. So the need for a letter of comfort is established by the board primarily has got requirements to consider whether it's a going concern from 12 months of the date of signing those accounts. And therefore, in providing a letter of comfort, the government would have reference to that. And that's why it's 12 months and not a different period. It's related to the boats itself, so it's for kind of technical reasons. I think on the broader question of the extent to which there's a blank cheque here or an open-ended commitment, again, I'd refer to answer around parliamentary approval and some of the caveats around due diligence. So the government has said it has it is committed to seeing through these boats, but that's not the same as advance approval and the formality that's required around approval of spending authorities as the boats progress. And there's an opportunity for the government to keep that under review. And as the Auditor General says, under the terms of the contract, there's opportunities to end the contract under certain circumstances. Effectively, the government needs to accept revised delivery dates for the boats as they go through.
Thanks very much indeed. Can I just turn to a couple of areas? The first one is, in paragraph 11 of your report, you highlight the fact, and I think this is just an amplification of a letter that the Chief Executive Officer of FMPG sent to the convener of the Scottish Parliament's Net Zero Committee, that the estimated cost for the Glen Sannox 801 is £101 million. And the estimated cost for 802 is £108.6 million. Why is 802 more expensive than 801?
I'll turn to colleagues, actually, if we can shed any further light on that. My assumption, convener, is that it relates to part of the factors that were identified in the due diligence review, that costs are increasing for the provision of materials, building supplies and so forth, that this vessel comes later and will be subject to a heightened period of inflated cost provision. Beyond that, if we have any further information, we can provide it just now. If not, we'll do our best. But it may be that it's a question that FMPG are better placed to answer.
Yeah, no, that's fine. As I say, I suppose the expectation would have been that the second vessel would benefit from lessons learned in the construction of the first vessel, and that would therefore lead to a reduction in the cost base, but maybe not.
And I should say, convener, that might well be the case as well, and it would have been higher still if the but it would be, these are only speculations on my part. I think the yard themselves are better placed.
Thanks. Could I just ask a couple of questions then about the kind of wider business picture and the future of the yard? Because I think I can speak for the committee as a whole in saying that when we ask these questions, it's because we want the yard to succeed and we want it to have a long-term future. One of the things which the present management team are involved in is an arrangement with BAE Systems. And I think that's involved. I mean, from memory, when we visited the yard, that didn't just involve sending FMPG employees down to the BAE Systems yards in Glasgow. I think that was also about work being brought from BAE Systems to be carried out in Port Glasgow. But you do say in the report that we've got before us this morning that there were some cash flow issues which arose from uncertainties about that financial arrangement between BAE Systems and FMPG. I wonder whether you could elaborate a bit more on what those uncertainties are.
I'll start and I'll bring Joanne in to say what more we know about that, convener. Our intent for including this in our report is exactly as you described, really to look beyond the delivery of these two vessels and to provide certainty to the workforce, the future of shipbuilding and what that might mean for island communities by extension who rely on these vessels. Clearly, the vast bulk of FMPG's activity is on 801 and 802, but as it looks to the future, and perhaps related to the report that you alluded to earlier about, you know, future options, how it gets itself to being a competitive provider of shipbuilding services. And where it currently is, though, is that its other income, as described in accounting terms, is relatively small and is confined to its relationship with BAE. You're right, there are secondments of FMPG employees to BAE to support that arrangement. And that may be a fruitful avenue for it to grow its other operations. But we draw attention to the relativity of that's quite small by comparison to the provision. So once these two vessels are delivered, it needs to have a plan, but that plan has to start now for it to be able to transition from the delivery of 801 and 802 to future operations. I'm clear and a high expectation that's very much part of the Scottish Government's review that it's currently undertaking. I'll stop and invite Joanne to say more.
In terms of the cash flow, we were obviously looking at the cash flow from an audit perspective, and it's been touched on about the 12 months from the date of signing. So the majority of the funding for FMPG, the income stream, is 801, 802. As part of their group setup, they do have a commercial entity, a commercial limited subsidiary. When we looked at the cash flows and the future forecasts for the cash flows in there, at the moment, the only balance in there is a related to BAE Systems, which in terms of income at the point of our audit was relatively small scale. And we were conversation with management around that wider business plan and how there was potential there for that to be upskilled. Equally, there was potential for Ferguson's to look and take on different commercial work. But from a look at the commercial cash flow, there wasn't sufficient cash flow there for a sustainable business, and that's why within our audit report we talk about the importance of this business plan, the importance of the future direction, and that future direction will also allow the yard to better understand what workforce requirements are needed and what level of investment, whether they continue to work with BAE as planned or whether there's other contracts that are potentially in the pipeline for them. So that was really just quite important around the cash flow position. So it wasn't related to the BAE work, it was the wider cash flow of the organisation and how sustainable that was at the point of time of doing the audit.
Thanks. I mean, you've both spoken about it being small scale. Could you give the committee an idea of what it is as a proportion of the income that's going into FMPG? I mean, is it 2%? Is it 10%, 15%?
Just looking at the FMPG annual report and accounts, if I can lay my hands on that convener. I'll update you. If Joanne has it, she might be better. Yeah. Thanks, Kavira. Mark's just going to have a quick look at that. Maybe we'll come back to that.
You can come back to that. And because the other area was, and I guess I'm asking you if you want to add to what you said earlier on, because it's in this whole area of First Marine International report. Is that the report which has been commissioned by the government and the yard? Is there other work going on? What is the synergy between the Scottish Government, the sponsorship team, and the yard in developing a plan for a viable long-term future?
Some of that I don't know the answer to. So I don't know if the consultants that FMPG commissioned are producing the same. That's the same report that the Scottish Government are going to use to for it to determine its own financial viability. We understand, and as I mentioned earlier, Convener, that it's the two reviews. So one has been the due diligence of the costs, and then this wider review, which is my understanding this was a Scottish Government-led review as opposed to Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow. The government could confirm exactly how those two reviews interact. That needs to be transparent, quite clearly. You know, there is no merit for that report to sit and be internal only. It has to be clear publicly what the government's intention is, not just for the workforce, but the very clear, you know, financial implications, commitments, as Joanne's mentioned about, you know, the change in scale from the delivery of 801, 802 to future provision. But how all those reviews work together, Convener, is a matter really for the government and FMPG. From our perspective, though, it has to be clear publicly what the intent is at the completion of them.
And you use advisedly the word reviews plural there. Mm. I mean, it is a little bit confusing, almost maybe perhaps in the realms of bewildering, that there could be more than one review which presumably has got broadly similar terms of reference. It's about, you know, a business plan for the yard, what can be done to give it a sustainable future, and, you know, what does the market look like, presumably as part of the research which an organisation like FMI would be carrying out. I mean, why wouldn't there just be one review signed off by both FMPG and the Scottish Government?
I'm maybe less surprised than Frank Convener that there would be more than one review, given the different relationship that exists both between the yard as the provider, a company, and also a non-departmental public body. But from the Scottish Government's perspective, they're the funder of this arrangement, so there is a different relationship between the two. And I do appreciate that there is a blurring of those boundaries with both being public bodies. And I'm not making any comment about the cost of no understanding at this point what these reviews are costing, notwithstanding what's been reported in the newspaper article. But I can understand why there might be a differently commissioned review from either party. Caveat to all of that, though, is that you wouldn't want to duplicate the reviews if that could be avoided, and there would need to be an eye on the cost as well.
Well, again, the cost as reported is £200,000, isn't it, for this FMI report, which is the one where there is some concern about it being covered by a non-disclosure agreement. I'm going to move on to the final area before I bring Willie Coffey in of my questioning, and that's to go in a slightly different direction. One of the things that you highlight in the report is the question of the demographics of the workforce, in the context of the broader point about skills and whether or not we are planning sufficiently to invest in the skills that we're going to need in the future. I mean, to what extent is it your opinion that the Scottish Government is addressing what you've identified to be a skills shortage?
Just to clarify, Kavira, do you mean in totality of Scotland's public sector workforce or just specifics of
shipbuilding skills, I'm interested in.
So I don't know the answer to that, if I'm frank. The extent to which the Scottish Government has a clear understanding of what shipbuilding skills will be needed, how it can access those. We draw attention to this in today's report is so that it's a factor that has to be considered really carefully in terms of the future viability of the yard. It's all very well to have intent to secure new contracts for the provision, but as is highlighted, Ferguson Marine currently has a highly skilled workforce, but it's also an ageing workforce, and it's using contractors to support the delivery of the vessels. That may well be the intent, that, and we're not expressing any view on that, we've not done any audit work on it, but as part of the overall assessment of the viability of the yard, we have to be absolutely clear where the skills, where the labour, the skilled labour is coming from. So again, we would assume and expect that when the government completes its viability assessment, it will have a clear understanding of what labour provision will be available, not just in the immediate term, but in the years to come, and how it will plug that gap if it doesn't currently exist.
Yeah, I mean, I think that what I'm referring to is that there's a line in the report which says that FMPG consider there to be, quote, limited shipbuilding skills available in Scotland, and that to date it has been unable to compete effectively with the private sector for skilled staff. So again, I don't know whether you want to address that point.
Yeah, of course. I mean, that's a very clear risk to the future viability. So there are many factors to that, convener, that, you know, its ability to compete with private sector, which feels, I guess, unusual in the relatively short time that it's been a public entity. So I don't have a clear picture whether that competitiveness was a factor when Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited was the provider. But these are the factors that the yard's business plan will have to make assumptions. Its workforce plan will have to be part of that, about how it secures and retains a future workforce. There are no shortage of labour in the longer term that's supported by adequate training, apprenticeships and so forth that could provide a future for the yard. It's transitioning from where they are now into a longer term workforce that will be the key task for the management of the yard and the Scottish Government.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm now going to invite Willie Coffey to put some questions to you. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. I wonder if I could just follow that question briefly, Auditor General. The yard is able to offer 18 secondments to BAE, yet it's bringing in contractors to complete the work. How do we square that? Is it different skills going out and different skills coming in? Or could you explain that? Because it doesn't seem to make sense to me that we let 18 staff be seconded away when we still have to bring in contractors to complete the work.
Good morning, Mr. Coffey. I'll ask Joanne to pick that up.
Ferguson's themselves operate, in effect, a flexible workforce model where they do have highly skilled and experienced individuals who are employed by Ferguson's. They also make use of a flexible pool of contractors as and how that's needed in terms of the delivery of 801 and 802. The individuals that are seconded out to BAE Systems are not needed at this point in time in 801, 802. And it does link to the wider point about upskilling the members of the employees of Ferguson's, where as part of this arrangement with BAE Systems, they will be learning different and new skills, which they are then able to bring back to Ferguson's. But the Chief Executive, I believe, has assured relevant parties that those individuals being seconded is not detrimental to the delivery of 801, 802. And just my knowledge of shipbuilding is not great, to be honest, but in terms of the what skills are needed when, it's at very fixed points in time, and that's how they've then managed the delivery between 801 and 802 as well.
We needed that assurance, Convener, that clearly that's providing an income stream and we're waiting for the value and the figures associated with that go to the yard. But, of course, the Scottish Government's paying ultimately for the contractors that are coming in. But provided it's different skills, that's the assurance, I think, that we're looking for. Could I ask a few questions, if I may, on the bonus payment issue? You said in your opening remarks, Stephen, that FMBG is required to comply with the Scottish Public Finance Manual requirements. Do you think the process of awarding these bonuses to the senior management team without any reference to performance indicators complies with the requirements of the manual?
I think I maybe need to be absolutely clear in this, Mr. Coffey, that Ferguson and Port Glasgow, as a non-departmental public body, is required to comply with the Scottish Public Finance Manual. However, the Scottish Government public sector pay policy arrangements don't apply utterly prescriptively to FMPG, but there is then, unfortunately, I'm going to drift into perhaps ambiguous terms, but it has to have words like have reference to and parallels and understanding to pay policy. But the framework document doesn't provide sufficient clarity around that. That's now come from Scottish Government following the publication of the audit report. On the payment of the bonuses, I said in my opening remarks that we consider it unacceptable that £87,000 of public money was paid in bonuses, not in an ideological perspective, but that the payments were made without clear KPI framework that was designed to support the payment of bonuses. Bonuses are relatively unusual in a public sector context. They do happen in a small number of other public bodies, but where they are made, there needs to be clear KPI, clear governance arrangements. And we draw attention to today's report that those factors weren't in existence when these amounts were paid.
Do you think that that money is ultimately recoverable? I need to ask that. I'm sure the public is asking that. It beggars belief that a bonus could be applied to this, given that the votes are 5 years late. So what constitutes a bonus criteria in any of that to justify the senior managers taking that award?
I don't know if those amounts are recoverable. That would have to be a judgment made by others in terms of the specifics of the terms and conditions that existed for those senior managers and what their contracts said. We draw attention to these amounts, Mr. Coffey, because primarily, of course, that the amounts were paid without effective governance by the Remuneration Committee being discharged before the amounts were paid, that it was clear what performance measures had been met, that there was adequately scrutinised before payments were made. But also, I think it's a matter of public interest that bonuses were paid to senior managers at the Yard, balanced against the challenges that have been widely reported by this committee and elsewhere on the costs and timescales for the delivery of the two vessels.
There's no sense that any of the workforce received any bonus payment. It was just the six senior managers that you referred to in the report.
I'll ask Joanne if she's in detail on that.
From the perspective of the audit, it was just those six individuals that received that payment.
Who ultimately would have approved that? Is that a senior management, a board decision? Well, surely the six that got the bonus were not part of that decision-making process.
I'll start, and Joanne can say a bit more. So we understand that the bonuses, there was two parts to the bonus. One was on intended to be on the delivery of the hull, as I understand, of vessel 801, which comprised 7.5% of the bonus. And then there was a further 10% discretionary element. The governance and decision-making around that, Mr. Coffey, was based on a recommendation by the former turnaround director, chief executive, to the remuneration committee of FMPG to make those payments. But as I'm sure Joanne wants to pick up, it's our view that that wasn't sufficiently robust. It wasn't clear whether the KPIs had been met. And again, speaks to real ambiguity about progress and process. Has led Joanne and the judgment that I repeat in the Section 22 report, that these were made without adequate decision-making having been in place. I'll pause and Joanne can elaborate.
Just to add to that, the actual approval, as we understand it, was through the Remuneration Committee. Aside from the KPI point, it is referenced as well that the level of detail in things like the Remuneration Committee minutes, the board minutes, particularly earlier on in our period of appointment, were very limited in detail. There wasn't anything in that REMCO paper which expanded on the rationale or the discussion that committee potentially had around it, and it was approved by them. From looking at the board minutes, which again were very light in detail, we couldn't see reference to it in the board. And it was based on the short paper that the turnaround director presented to the REMCO, which they subsequently approved.
You mentioned the word completion, Auditor General, that was part of this, part of whatever the KPI framework, whatever shape it took, that word was in there. So they decided to award themselves this bonus on completion of the hull, which was years late. How on earth can that be? Why isn't it successful completion or a timescaled completion or that kind of language being part of a bonus award scheme, that it can still be validly paid even if it's years late?
I'm not here to offer any mitigation, Mr. Coffey. I think this is a new management team that has come into Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow, inherited the circumstances that they were appointed to. The payment of bonuses in public sector, really in any organisation, but certainly the public sector, has to be done transparently on the basis of a clear performance framework supported by robust governance. That's what we draw attention to in today's report. A couple of points, if I may, just to add to that. I think as we heard the Deputy First Minister, the former Deputy First Minister in the statement to Parliament, is that the Scottish Government weren't aware of these bonuses and nor did they approve them. We understand that those arrangements have been tightened as they now exist. Bonuses still exist, though, I should say, Mr. Coffey, in the contracts of senior officials at Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow. So the new Chief Executive has a bonus arrangement in their contract to be paid on the basis of delivery of KPIs. It is the case that no bonus was paid for the Chief Executive in the 21-22 year. And we hope that these arrangements are enacted and improved upon going forward. And certainly the external auditors, as Grant Thornton have done for this year, will keep a close eye on this as part of their audit work.
In terms of timing of it, can you pinpoint any timing issue here? When exactly the bonuses were taken compared to when more public funds were being given to the yard? Is there any comparison that you can draw there? Were they closely associated in time? So what I'm trying to get is, were the bonuses paid while the public purse was paying the yard more money to complete the ships?
I'll ask Joanne to pick up a bit more detail on the timing, but I think yes, that is the case. So the public, you know, this is given that, unfortunately, I don't think we're able to lay our hands on the relativity of the amounts that of other income is being derived from BAE systems, but it is a very small fraction of the total income that FMPG receives. What that means effectively, the Scottish Government is funding the provision of services, both materials, the delivery of vessels, and also staff costs. So it is public funds that are paying for bonuses. If you're asking though about the timing of additional funding requests. Joanne might have that detail, just check. If not, we can come back to the committee.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just to pick up on the point, and we can get you the exact number that comes through the income from BAE monthly, but at the point of our audit, it certainly wasn't any more than 1-2% of the total income that Ferguson's were receiving. In terms of the timing, the REMCO paper was round about February 21 and reflected on the position of the hull. I don't believe it was associated with any change in delivery milestones or any change in funding. It was looking at it at the point of view of the hull completion and the end of the financial year 2021, which meant the payments were made in 21-22's accounts.
You've answered the question about whether FMPG sought approval, and they've made that clear that they didn't. But finally, Auditor General, in your view, do you think the decision to award the bonus payments shows a complete lack of awareness of the seriousness of the situation within the yard, and for the management team to award themselves those bonuses was completely and utterly inappropriate?
I've said publicly, Mr. Coffey, I thought that the payment of these bonuses in these circumstances without a proper KPI framework, without adequate scrutiny and effective governance around the payments is unacceptable.
Thank you. Thank you for that, Convener.
Thanks. I think Bill Kidd wanted to come in on this question. Bill.
Yes, please. Thanks, Convener. Now, just to re-emphasise, if you don't mind, out of your own report and what you've stated there, that it was a lack of transparency and good governance around the assessment and approval of the payments. In your report, you also do state that FMPG's Remuneration Committee membership consists of the chair of the board, two non-executive board members and the turnaround director. And I think it just doesn't do any harm just to emphasise who was actually making these making the right of these payments to be made, because I think that actually, to me, suggests that there wasn't proper oversight being taken of what was happening in the situation from outside.
So just to elaborate on that, Mr. Kidd, so yes, you're right, you've set out the membership of the Remuneration Committee of Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow, which is a committee of the board overall, which is overall responsible for the effective governance of Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow. You've quoted from the report that good effective governance, effective operation of a remuneration committee as it considers senior manager salaries and bonus payments would be to follow proper scrutiny around performance KPI framework, that's clear in terms of deliverables, that's scrutinised effectively, and we haven't seen effective processes around the payment of these £87,000 of bonuses. In terms of what's happened since, it's maybe worth also just updating the committee that in November of last year, so after these events, the FMPG REMCO has considered a revised performance framework for its senior managers and the chief executive. We understand, and Joanne might be able to say a bit more about current events, is that's still awaiting approval and consideration by the Scottish Government. Convener, I think it speaks to the matter at the start of the meeting that there is a lack of clarity about how the Scottish Government expects Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow to operate as both a public body and a company limited by guarantee that's operating in a commercial environment. These matters need to be resolved so to avoid a repeat of the bonus issue and the wider need for viability of the yard.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. That's yes, that's a very clear message. Craig Hoy has got further related matters that he wants to bring up.
Thank you,
Craig.
Good morning, Mr. Ball. Just for clarity and just to some extent to recap, from your perspective, does the yard have a viable future?
So, if I may, Mr. Hoy, I think it's a question that we're perhaps not in a position to answer quite yet, until we see the conclusion of the Scottish Government's assessment of the yard's deliverables. What we'd look to do to point to in today's report is really looking beyond the delivery of the Glen Sannox and Vessel 802, is that there isn't a long-term order book. There is, you know, progress in terms of the relationship with BAE Systems, but in order to transition effectively to a long-term successful shipyard, there has to be a clear business plan supported by a viable workforce, and that's what's awaited. So at the moment, I'm not able to say yes, it does, or no, it doesn't, until there's clear, transparent view on there is a potentially successful business plan.
Yeah. The Scottish Government and the former First Minister have said, when asked about what has gone wrong and the shortcomings and the misgivings, that we should lay all that to one side because ultimately they have saved the yard and saved the jobs at the yard. In light of what you said, is it premature to say that this yard has a long-term future that is safe?
I think that's clear. That, you know, there are two significant vessels to deliver in terms of 801 and 802, but there are doubts about the long-term viability until it is clear that there is a plan in place. And as we've discussed, that plan is awaited.
Thanks. Mr. Coffey obviously asked about the bonus payments. I think in paragraph 26, the report confirms that the framework agreement includes an overall framework for pay, but this wasn't formally agreed until March 2022, which was obviously after the bonus payments were approved. Given that FMPG came into public ownership in November 2019, why do you think it took so long to establish that vitally important framework for pay?
I think that's a question for the Scottish Government to be absolutely clear in its perspective on the timescale. I'm going to ask Joanne to come in because we know that there were considerable conversations, iterations of the framework agreement, and Joanne can set that out for the committee. But even in settling and on a framework agreement, Mr. Hoy, we still have ambiguity. So, you know, a challenging process was undertaken to arrive at a framework agreement, but it's still not delivering the clarity that really the public body deserves. In fact, Port Glasgow deserves to have absolute clarity on what's expected from it. So there is work still to be done. What preceded that, Joanne can set out for the committee.
In terms of the development of the framework agreement, I understand it took about 12 to potentially 18 months to get that agreed between both parties. An initial version shared by Scottish Government was very much a NDPB template framework agreement, and Ferguson's highlighted a number of points and concerns around that framework and how they would be able to, in practice, comply with the framework. One of those was around whether public sector pay policies applied or didn't apply and what was intended in some of the wording within the agreement. The agreement itself proved a little bit more complex as well because of Ferguson's group structure and the fact they have a limited company, and whether that was nuanced sufficiently within the framework agreement from the point of view of Ferguson's. So that was then officially agreed in March 22, but there were a period of time of discussions there.
Okay. Mr. Ball, you mentioned that the language was somewhat opaque around the issue of the pay policy, and I think you say that pay should be broadly consistent with the provisions of the Scottish Government's pay policy and that any significant deviations would require further approval. So in February 2023, the Scottish Government provided clarification on these requirements. Can you provide further detail on what those clarifications were? And are you confident with the steps that the Scottish Government has subsequently taken?
I'm going to ask Joanne just to kind of say a bit more, or Mark, if he wishes, on the specifics of the clarification. I think the signs of progress, Mr. Hoy, that there is move towards a clearer understanding of how Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow is intended to operate as a public body. And just stepping back for a moment, if I may, particularly around pay arrangements, we look to draw attention to the arrangements that that now exist for the Chief Executive. I mentioned a few moments ago in terms of the performance-related pay and the, as a matter of public records, the salary arrangements for the Chief Executive. That's quite at odds with the salary arrangements for the former turnaround director, and we include in the report the overall salary. So it speaks to the fact that Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow, yes, is an NDPV, but it still has to operate and recruit, you know, very specialist skills in a different environment from other public bodies. So I understand the need for that flexibility, but it's the clarity with which how it has to operate and marry up those two factors that matters. Well, that's Joanne first, or indeed Mark. I think Mark was coming first.
As I understand it, as the Auditor General said, the November 22 Remuneration Committee for Ferguson's have proposed KPIs around potential bonus payments, and there's 9 KPIs, and that also includes the KPI framework to assess the Chief Executive and whether they as an individual are entitled to a bonus payment. That has not yet been approved by Scottish Government. Ferguson's have shared it with Scottish Government for approval, and at this point in time I understand that is something that they're still discussing, alongside how Ferguson's can potentially benchmark their salary pay arrangements with other similar entities to Ferguson to determine whether that's reasonable or otherwise. But again, that's a matter for Ferguson's and Scottish Government to seek approval on.
And just add a couple of overall observations. One's around the timing. So I think we've been clear the Scottish Government wasn't asked for approval around the bonuses that were paid. Mm-hmm. It's our understanding that as a result of learning about those bonuses, that clarification was then provided about how the system would work. And stepping, I guess, given an overview of the detail of that, right at the heart of that is any future bonus schemes or bonus payments required to be approved by the government. And I think that clarification, for me, is amongst the essence of what that discussion was about.
And just in relation to the Chief Executive's bonus, I think the provision is potentially for 40% of the base salary to be granted as a bonus. You say that obviously those negotiations are ongoing. What would cause there to be a delay in that? Because it would seem to me a relatively easy thing to benchmark. Is that the prevailing rate in the private sector, recognising you say that there has to be some consistency with the private sector? So is there any, should we read anything into the fact that that hasn't yet been agreed and the status is somewhat delayed?
I'm not sure we're cited in any immediate challenges to that framework. I'm not cited yet on the it's a matter for FMPG's internal governance at this stage, their assessment of the delivery of the KPI framework that Mark mentions. It's something we'll review as part of this year's audit and report further, Mr. Hoy.
Right. And just finally, when we visited the yard, some of the workers who'd been there from the get-go said that at various stages they likened it to a gravy train running through the middle of the yard, where the people who were doing the work were not being necessarily rewarded, but certainly senior management were at various points. And that gave, I think, us some cause for concern. Obviously, it appears that the issue of pay is now being addressed satisfactorily. Are there any other areas, expenses or the use of contractors or third-party agencies, that could give you cause for concern in the future? Or have you adequately looked into all other areas of potential expenditure?
I'll maybe say one thing. Joanne will certainly have a perspective on that as part of her audit. And probably just to repeat the point I made earlier about value for money, which is a phrase that remains undefined in terms of the Scottish Government's expectations of Ferguson Marine to deliver value for money for the public purse. It is reasonable for the accountable officer, especially with the nature of the framework and the funding arrangements for the Scottish Government, to have clarity on the funder, the Scottish Government's expectations about the criteria with which a value for money judgment will be made. That needs to be brought into place. But in terms of the overall assessment, as Joanne and her colleagues at Grant Thornton, they'll have considered value for money as part of their overall audit, based on and informed by the judgments that the yards management have made, as much as they're able to, Joanne.
In terms of the salaries and wages and the contractors, in terms of the forecasts for 801, 802, those are very detailed, and that's where the due diligence happened, and that included salary inflation, it included pay changes, and it included a challenge back around contractors, the cost of contractors, and also where potentially if a contractor failed to deliver, what clawback Ferguson would have around that. And that was subject to the due diligence requested by Scottish Government. In terms of wider pay at the yard, they obviously have in place unions, and that's discussed with the unions. Any approval of annual salary changes, etc., that has to be signed off by Scottish Government, and Scottish Government have to approve that.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, can I just pick up on that point before I bring in Bill Kidd? And that's to go back to the framework agreement. So I think, Joanne Brown, you said that it was 12 to 18 months in the making. The framework agreement as regards pay talks about maintaining regular dialogue on any pay proposals with Scottish Government finance pay policy, with an expectation that these pay proposals will be broadly consistent with the provisions of Scottish Government pay policy for staff pay remit. Any significant deviations will require further approval. So I guess my question is, you know, was that iteration in circulation at the point at which the turnaround director drafts a paper which is approved in February 2022, just a month before the framework agreement with those clauses in it is introduced? Was it a preemptive strike by the turnaround director?
It's hard to be definitive on that, convener. Actually, I think we want to be absolutely clear in terms of the extant text of the framework agreement that was in place when those bonus payments were made. So I'm hesitant to say that's the case. I'll maybe ask Joanne to kind of think about further about that.
I think there's probably a couple of points on timeline just to pick up on. So in terms of the entitlement or the potential entitlement to this bonus of up to 20%, that was obviously in these employees' contracts, which were put in place in 2019 by the turnaround director, when those individuals transferred or joined Ferguson's as a public sector entity. In terms of the actual timing of the remuneration committee, the approval of the bonuses, they were paid in the 21-22 accounts. The actual approval happened in April 21. So actually it was before the March 22 when the framework agreement was approved. There was also somewhat complicated process when Ferguson's became a public sector entity to make the turnaround director the accountable officer. And at that point, the turnaround director wasn't made an accountable officer until November 21. And that also reiterated the SPFM requirements. So there is a little bit of ambiguity around the time frame and the sequencing of what applied when. But the framework agreement broadly remained consistent on those points in the drafting of the document.
But there is a possibility there could have been a preemptive strike. I mean, if I look at the 2021-22 pay policy guidelines of the Scottish Government, I mean, it's for those, the guidelines are, OK, it's a minimum, but it's 2% pay increase for public sector workers who earn more than £25,000 up to £40,000, and it's a 1% guidance figure for those earning between £40,000 and £80,000. So the payment of a 17.5% bonus is in anybody's terms a significant deviation from the pay policy.
No doubt about that, convener. And I don't think it's the only example. I mean, so perhaps more significantly than the bonus, and I know it's been a matter that the committee has considered previously, and we highlight this at paragraph 28 to the report, was the overall remuneration of the turnaround director, which, you know, doesn't bear reference to what other, as Joanne mentioned, other accountable officers would be paid. So there are really significant differences to the pay arrangements that were in place when Ferguson Engineering Limited existed and then transitioned, and then some of those practices continued operating as a commercial entity would, but being funded by public purse. So I think that there is a whole host, both the bonus payments and some of the overall remuneration arrangements, that were quite at odds with public sector pay and rates that would be paid elsewhere in the public sector.
Yeah, and I think for us as a public audit committee, the question is not just that these things happened, but that they were allowed to happen. And where is the sponsorship team and where is the government's oversight of this? Is it seems to me quite a fundamentally important question here.
Yeah, I agree absolutely. Can you know that there, I've used this phrase a lot this morning, actually, there has been prolonged ambiguity about the government's intentions manifesting itself, the duration that the framework agreement took to be agreed, that it still contains sections that are open to interpretation, suggests that there needs to be real clarity provided as quickly as possible, bearing in mind, of course, that whilst Ferguson Marine may be operating as a commercial entity, as we've discussed this morning, it's almost exclusively funded by public funds.
Thank you. I've got a final couple of questions from Bill Kidd, so I'm going to invite Bill now to put those questions.
Thank you very much, Convener. Now, I don't want to just be reiterating something that's been stated a few thousand times, although it does seem, as your report refers, to the approval of the Ferguson Marine Remuneration Committee of a performance framework for senior managers and the chief executive has not yet been discussed with or approved by the Scottish Government. So I'm not sure if there have been developments in terms of seeking approval as such. I mean, you have mentioned that there have been moves to talk about these things, but have there been any real developments taking place which can say that we're going in the right direction here in terms of relationships between the company and the Scottish Government?
I'll maybe pick up the relationships point. I'll ask Joanne just to say a bit more. I think she's partly covered in terms of the KPI framework and the remuneration. There's clearly ongoing engagement between the sponsorship team of the Scottish Government and Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow. I think what we are asking, both through the annual audit report and the Section 22 report, is given the risks that exist, given the ongoing nature of the delivery of these contracts that have continued to call on further public funds and delays, is the government satisfied that the relationship, its sponsorship of Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow, is operating as it wants to? There isn't a one-size-fits-all approach to sponsorship of public bodies. And I think that feels quite a contrast. It's not a perfect analogy, Mr. Kidd, but that the original intent around the framework agreement was a fairly generic, non-departmental public body. Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow is far from a generic NDPB. So the government and Ferguson really need to be satisfied that relationship is operating and is managing risks and safeguarding public funds. I'll stop and ask Joanne to say a bit more about what we know of the approval arrangements for PE.
So the revised KPI framework was considered and approved by the Ferguson's Remuneration Committee in November. We understand that that was shared with the Scottish Government in February for their consideration and subsequent approval, and that those discussions are still ongoing between Ferguson's and Scottish Government. There is a piece of work, as I understand it, around benchmarking salaries, senior salaries, but also just salaries more widely across the sector. And there's also a piece at looking at the employee contracts and what's within a contract and what is sufficient from a public sector openness and transparency perspective, along with what contractually potentially Ferguson's are required to deliver on. But those discussions are ongoing and a matter for Ferguson's and Scottish Government.
Well, on that basis then, the fact that, as your report states, the Scottish Government commissioned an independent review of Ferguson Marine estimates, of course, concluded that Ferguson Marine cost estimates are reasonable, but more contingency needs to be built in as risks still remain. Is that basically where you're going with this, that, that this is an ongoing process and there's still a lot of work left to be done in terms of bringing Ferguson Marine under a more sustainable route towards success and continuing work once these two ferries are completed?
I think it's a number of things that are part of that. The section of the report you quote specifically relates to the due diligence that the government undertook on Ferguson's request for additional public funding and, you know, made the broad assessment that they were reasonable, but that they contained risks, particularly around the need for additional contingency in light of past history, and then other factors that are included around future cost growth, cost inflation, the delivery of supplies and so forth. I think it's too early to say that that provides the secure, solid foundation that future costs are manageable and then beyond into the delivery of a viable long-term future. That judgment can only be made when I think we have clarity from the Scottish Government. The awaited report alongside that about what the future viability will be. I think only upon reading that will we know more about what the future holds.
Okay. And then we can feel more confident about sponsorship arrangements working in the effective manner in which they should be.
I think these two things have to go hand in hand. Right. You know, that there is, it's effectively, so sponsorship arrangements in other public bodies, they're a key part of the government getting assurance, getting early understanding of progress of events that ultimately the public body is doing what it is intended to do. The risk is heightened in Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow, given the scale of public interest and the, perhaps unlike other public bodies, it's rare for other public bodies to be coming back with what would typically be additional supplementary estimates, budget requests and spring, autumn revisions. The scale of Ferguson's request and the pattern requires really effective two-way relationship and robust sponsorship arrangements.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, thank you very much indeed. We've run slightly over the time we'd anticipated, but I think it was important to draw out some of those important pieces of evidence that that you've given us this morning. So, as always, can I thank you very much for your cooperation and your frankness. It's been very helpful for us, and we will, of course, need to determine what our next steps are. But for the moment, can I thank Auditor General, Mark Taylor and Joanne Brown for your candour this morning. It's been very valuable. And I'm now going to move the committee into private session. Thank you.